The topics and opinions expressed on the following show are solely those of the hosts and their guests and not those of W4WN Radio, its employees, or affiliates. We make no recommendations or endorsements for radio show programs, services, or products mentioned on air or on our web. No liability, explicit or implied, shall be extended to W4WN Radio, its employees, or affiliates. Any questions or comments should be directed to those show hosts. Thank you for choosing W4WN Radio.
Did you know women represent just 3% of Fortune 500 CEOs and less than 15% of corporate executives at top companies worldwide? Have you wondered what the secrets are to getting into the top ranks, whether in the private or public sector? Do you want to figure out how to stop being held back in your career or passed over for promotion? Then you're in the right place. Hi, I'm Dr. Madeline Ann Lewis, President and CEO of the Executive Women's Success Institute. I have decades of experience in the military, the federal government, and corporate America, and my mission is to help women succeed and tap into their full potential. I want to reach a million plus women around the world to become the leaders they are meant to be. So if you want to move into a management or executive level position, or maybe you are a female veteran transitioning out of the military into business entrepreneurship, then reach out to the Executive Women's Success Institute at 301-693-3284. Let us get you on the fast track to success. Well, hello and welcome to the Success for Women show, where you can view us on Talk for TV and listen to us on the Woman for Women Network. I am Dr. Madeline Ann Lewis, your host, and my mission is to help women accelerate the path to success. Well, today's topic is Make Your Presence Felt. And my guest is Ms. Selena Rezvani. Let me just give you a little bit of background on her. Selena Rezvani is an internationally known women's leadership speaker, inclusion consultant, TEDxer, LinkedIn learning instructor, and an award-winning journalist and author. Selena's mission is to help women and underrepresented groups carve out paths to leadership. She's the author of two leadership books, the bestseller, Pushback, and The Next Generation of Women Leaders. Selena addresses thousands of professionals each year and has been featured in TEDx, Harvard Business Review, Inc., todaysshow.com, and NPR. And she's also a columnist for NBC News, Know Your Value. I'd like to welcome to the Success for Women show, Ms. Selena Rezvani.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Lewis. It's great to be here, and I'm a big fan of your work. So thanks for having me.
It's great to have you here. I know it took us a little while to connect, but we finally did. So I'm excited to have you here today to share some great nuggets. So, but first, before I start out, I always give the standard bio on my guests, but then I like to ask them for them to tell us what you want our viewers and listeners to know about Selena Rezvani.
Yeah. Well, yeah, there's a lot beyond, you know, just the resume and the quick paragraph for sure. You know, I think one of the things I want people to know, one of the reasons I'm so, you know, fired up about developing leaders is I myself have had this ambivalent relationship with power. lots of my life. You know, whether that was imposter feelings and struggling with self-doubt and noticing the impact that had, how I kind of diluted my meanness and you know, tried to fit in some corporate environments, and how bad that felt. You know, I've walked that path. I kind of can really appreciate the struggle of wanting very much to feel like enough to bring your full Technicolor self to work. And I found a system that has enabled me to do that. And in some ways it's been counterintuitive, but that's really what gets me so excited about this topic is just having walked that zigzaggy path of confidence myself, both face plants, struggles, but also triumphs. Absolutely. And that makes me excited to share what I know.
Well, great. And we're glad to have you here to share. But tell me, you just finished writing a new book, Quick Confidence, and it's due out this year. So what about your personal story makes you want to write and speak on confidence?
Yeah, well, you know, I think I had some of my own struggles to fit in going way back. I think I've been on a search for belonging. I come from a multiracial household. My mom's white, my dad's Pakistani. And, you know, growing up, as much as I appreciated a lot of the cool things of growing up in a multicultural home, I never felt like a full card-carrying member of either of my parents' communities. You know, I can still remember filling out the state form, what is your race, ethnicity, and checking other. And I always felt like a Martian, you know, like other. It just, and I think that in a lot of ways, I was on that search to belong, to feel I fit. I was a member, you know, and I brought that same kind of feeling with me into the workplace. And that's where I dealt with some of those struggles around, oh, can I be me? You know, truly who I am with the bright colors and the quirks and, you know, my sense of humor, or do I need to tamp all that down? And that's part of what got me passionate about confidence and stoking it, because I saw some other people and groups struggle with that as well, you know? And then fast forward to more recent times, you know, I had my own confidence crisis. During the pandemic, here I had like toiled really hard to grow my business and get it to a successful place, only to have it stall and really go quiet. And I thought, look, maybe there's a way to shore up my own bleeding confidence, you know, and help other people at the same time. And that's what made me start a newsletter called Quick Confidence. Wow. And yeah, I started putting that out weekly, and it is really beautiful. It became a community, went viral, 96,000 people today subscribed to it. And that became the book.
Wow. Now the book, did you write the book during the pandemic? Was that, you know, your kind of your release writing that book during that time?
It was my release, and it was, you know, as all books are, challenging. You know, you come up with like five other things to do to stall because absolutely, as you know, with big projects and TEDx talks and everything, it can be a daunting project. Yeah. But it's been such a labor of love. I have put everything I have into it because I just am a big believer. Confidence is not inconsequential stuff.
No.
It powers like our best contributions, our willingness to put our ideas out there, to make an impact, to be memorable. So I consider myself really lucky to get to help people on that journey.
Absolutely. And you do see a lot of, especially in the workplace, a lot of women, that's why they don't reach out and they don't maybe apply for certain positions. And it's a lot of times it's because of a lack of confidence, not a lack of ability or, you know, the skills or anything. It's because of the confidence factor that they may not go for certain things. Yeah.
Yeah, I think you're right. And I remember that from your TEDx, which was so well delivered, that message. And I think us as women do receive lots of messages to kind of temper our assertiveness with humility.
Yes.
If you're going to ask, do it very carefully or say it just right, or and that can feel sometimes contradictory, those messages. Stand up for yourself, but don't turn anybody off. Don't be too strident. I mean, this is difficult for a lot of women to find that perfect, socially acceptable balance. I'm right there with you, and all the more reason to speak your piece, to make your voice heard.
Absolutely. Toot your own horn. That's what I say.
Right. Because look, sometimes it's not always going to be welcome. Sometimes people around you aren't going to make you feel you belong.
Yes.
You still deserve to
Absolutely.
make your voice heard or signal to yourself that you belong.
Absolutely. So tell me, what role do you think the pandemic played in people's self-confidence, particularly when it came to or when it comes to speaking up at work?
Well, I don't know about you. You have tons of experience with professional women. But one of the things I've noticed is at times of flux and uncertainty, what do many of us want to do? We kind of want to go in our turtle shell and stay quiet, and kind of keep our heads down and play it a little bit safe. And for a lot of people, I really understand that. There was health and safety concerns, worries about loved ones who were susceptible. There was a lot of reasons to feel nervous, and kind of have some of your confidence drained. But one of the interesting things about the pandemic, the uncertainty, the challenges, is some of the research shows, well, many people felt stressed. Many people experienced anxiety and depression. The group most likely to report a loss in confidence is early stage professionals. And, I think that's unfortunate and something to pay attention to, because some of the thinking is that this is a group that didn't have the resources to deal with, that loss in confidence, the stress, the way maybe somebody who's older and more established and has a higher income might be able to come up with resources to help themselves. So I think the youngest among us, can use the support. All of us need to support each other, but I think there's some particular need there to help people starting out find their voice and find, that ability to say, "Hey, may I lead the project? Can I talk to you about the types of assignments and work I'm getting? I have some suggestions."
It's a good thing to step out there and do that because sometimes you have to put yourself out there and ask, for the, like you said, for those projects so that you can get noticed. I mean, so, that they can see what you can do because sometimes they may just assume you don't want to or you can't. But if you step out there and ask for that project, let me lead this or let me do this for 30 days. And then if you think that I'm not doing a good job, then you can, put somebody else in it. And that's always what I tell a lot of my clients too, that sometimes it's not sitting back and waiting for them to call on you. Sometimes you have to step out there and ask for that go for that opportunity.
I love that more active role versus the passive role. Let me wait and hope to get noticed. You are spot on. And I
And
think.
especially now, a lot of people working from home, you got to really make yourself get noticed now because you're working from home. You're not in front their faces every day.
You're so
You're on
right.
a screen a lot of times for your meetings. And I know now some of the people are starting to go back into the office maybe a couple of days a week or what have you, but you still have to do things to make sure that you're noticed and that they know that you're still being productive, that your skills are still there, that you're not slacking off. You know, that has to be in the forefront, especially when you're working from home too. Oh,
yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. I have an old saying I would tell people even before the pandemic, which is managers have short memories. Absolutely. They don't know all that you're doing often, let alone where you're shining and making a big difference, because they're busy. They mm-hmm. have other things happening. And I think that's, you know, times 20 when mm-hmm. you're remote. You really yeah. have to behave like nobody knows a thing about what okay. you're doing, you know, yeah. and be more of that good sideline reporter mm-hmm. sharing your wins, you know, your outcomes.
And you let them know what you've accomplished, because, you know, one of the things that I used to do, because, you know, you would get the evaluations all the time. So you can't sit there and hope that they see what you've been doing that entire time. I used to prepare my own. Whenever I did something, I would have I had the date, the timeline, what happened, you know, what I did, what my part was in it, what my role was. And I did it like that to submit to the supervisors so that they would have that information too. And it's not just what you've done sitting behind your desk. What if you're volunteering at an organization outside of where you are? Let them know about those things too. Because to me, those are valuable skills, too, that you've accomplished. I know a friend of mine, she is heading an organization that's outside of where she works. Now, to me, that looks great as something that you could put forward and make sure that your organization knows that you're leading an entire organization outside of where you're working. What way to let them know, hey, I have leadership skills. I may not use them here, but there's someone out there that recognizes them. And so I want to let you know that they are there. So you can call on me to lead this project or to do this or to do that. Yeah.
Absolutely. It's like, don't tell yourself no before they do. You know, you have to use all of that experience you have, and none of it is wasted, mm-hmm. but only if you use it, share it and articulate what That's you've right. done. That's so right. I really agree with that. And you said something I really appreciate that I think all of us can take quick confidence from, mm-hmm. which is almost making this mental shift in situations where you assume somebody else is leading the conversation, making a shift from seeing it as them led to co-produced, mm-hmm. co-directed. This mm-hmm. is a co-created mm-hmm. conversation. Mm-hmm. And so I think if you go into a job interview thinking that way, mm-hmm. I am not being led by the hand. This is co-created.
Absolutely.
I am a full, you know, 50% contributor to this and steering the direction. Mm-hmm. And same thing with a performance review. Like you said, coming prepared with your talking points, your self-evaluation.
Exactly.
That is very different mm-hmm. than simply coming in and passively saying, okay, mm-hmm. I'll listen.
Yeah, as they tell you what they saw, yes. didn't see. And yes. Yeah, absolutely. Wow.
And I think that's powerful in our lives in all kinds of situations. You know, they say in medicine, people who are stronger self-advocates are more likely to get the tests they need performed, right? So what we've always heard about the squeaky wheel getting the oil, I mean, it there makes a difference. But you got to be prepared. You got to walk in knowing, assuming I have an equal voice in this.
Exactly. So what do you think, and we hear this expression all the time, fake it till you make it. Why do you think fake it till you make it is trash advice?
I don't like it, Dr. Lewis. I don't like it. And listen, there's some people who might want to fight me on that. Mm-hmm. Listen, I'll be the first person to say, when you're in a pinch, you're going for that job interview, or maybe you have a board meeting and you're presenting. In the very short term, can mm-hmm. it help to play a part? you know, play the part of a confident person, sure, it can get you through that quick situation. But if you're somebody who wants lasting confidence, you know, there's more to that. And that's where a lot of the passion, you know, for my book comes in. And what I'm trying to teach people is, you know, I used to think confidence came just from big swings you take in life. You know, pitching to a venture capitalist or putting everything on the line and making a big move in your business. I don't see it that way anymore. I really believe it's something you can build slowly over time. But what it requires, I think at the heart of it, is a healthy respect for your strengths. And that's the problem I have with fake it till you make it. It's kind of a veneer. You know, I'm going to put on this mask and get the job done. But deep down, that's not empowering. You know, some would even argue it's disempowering, you know, because you're not integrating it with who you are. My concept here is to really develop a supportive kind of inner coach voice who can get you through all kinds of challenges and big goals. Help you develop that healthy respect for your unique strengths that only you bring, you know? And those are the people to me who have lasting confidence, like authentic confidence.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. So talk to us about some of the physical things that we can do to increase our confidence and, you know, just by using our body language, maybe talk to us.
Well, I don't know if anyone listening can relate to this situation, but I actually recently went to a networking event of executives and I felt really honored to be there. There was many people I was excited to meet, executives, CEOs, etc. And I was surprised and, you know, that when I got to that event, lots of the people were kind of standing with each other. If I went up to them, they'd kind of crowd me out or you know, turn in and speak to the person they knew, right? Lots of people knew each other there. And it stung, right? It feels pretty lousy when you feel I don't belong, you know? I can't make that connection. It's none of us like that feeling. And yet all of us have probably been there at one point or another when we felt that way. And so I think one of our instincts in situations like that is to play small with our bodies, to maybe low talk and to make cautious eye contact. You know, and to shrink or droop our posture a little bit, right?
Yeah.
That's how we might feel when we're feeling nervous and doubtful. And I want to encourage people in moments like that. One of the things that helped me that day was to do the opposite, to big up, okay? To be conspicuous, like I say, celebrate what your mama gave you and take up space. So that might mean doing things like instead of standing with arms pinned to your rib cage, pulling your arms out, you know, being willing to expand. And that's important because it sends a powerful signal to your brain that, you know what, I do belong. I am more than suitable. I am powerful. And I do deserve my seat at this table or at this event. So I want to challenge you in those moments you feel small to counter that.
Wow. That is that. Yeah, that makes sense. And now that's interesting that you said that, you know, as you joined maybe one of the groups, they kind of edged you out. Wow. That it would kind of mess with your confidence a little bit, you know, like, oh, so what? They don't think I'm good enough to be here, or, you know, maybe I shouldn't have come, you know, maybe I should, you know. Yeah, it definitely would. And you definitely would have to kind of have a game plan to figure out, okay, how do I make myself visible in this room of people who are just, you know, noticing who they think are, I guess, the ones that really belong here, maybe. I'm not even sure what that mindset was that would make them do that. But it's like you have to shift your mindset. And that kind of brings me to my next question about how about mindset? What shifts matter most there to improve confidence? How, you know, we know that everything begins in the head. So kind of what do you do? I know you said you kind of expand it, but are there some other things that you can do to really not let your confidence go down in the tubes when something like that happens?
Yes. Yes. And I think we all need those things, right? We can all get in that like overthinking mode, you know, analysis paralysis. And so mm-hmm. I think some of the mindset shifts are so important. Mm-hmm. And one that has been life-changing for me, really life-changing, has been one particular mantra that I have repeated to myself. And it comes from some of those struggles of not feeling enough, mm-hmm. you know, not feeling, almost feeling like, oh, do I belong at the kids' table?
Versus like this. Kind of what if I'm not good enough?
Yes. You're peering into my mind, Dr. Lewis. Like, yes, exactly. Mm-hmm. And I started practicing this before walking into, I'll never forget it, this like very fancy mahogany lined boardroom of a law firm where I was presenting. And I was very much feeling this, oh, do I belong? I don't know if I'm good enough for this place, etc. Mm-hmm. And I started saying to myself, I do belong. Right. I 400% belong. Mm-hmm. And I started coaching myself, walk into the room like you 400% belong. How would you carry yourself? How would you speak? How would you make a point, yeah. right? If you were behaving as though you 400% belong. And it's something that made a huge difference to me, because instead of just saying to myself, stop doing X, stop being nervous, stop being scared, stop mm-hmm. worrying about what if, it gave me something to fixate on, something positive that felt really encouraging to me. Like I 400% belong in this job interview, in this boardroom, in this leadership meeting. Mm-hmm. And it's like it helped me set an intention. And all my behavior and actions flowed from that. So with my own coaching clients, I encourage them to find one that really hits where they're feeling most vulnerable. I had one other client who used a mantra she liked because her fear was, I'm scared to take things on if I mess up. Okay. I'm excited about the project, but I'm kind of paralyzed to do anything about it because I don't want to mess up. Real perfectionistic. And the mantra she adopted was, if I make a mistake, I can right myself. Like a cat has a writing reflex. Mm-hmm. You know, if they fall, they somehow find a way to land on their feet.
Right.
You know, so I think it's up to each of us to say, what is this really about? What am I really so upset could happen? What is the worst case? In my case, they're going to find out I don't belong here. In my client's case, mm-hmm. I'm going to make a mistake and it'll be catastrophic. It'll end me. I almost encourage you to figure out what that thought is, because then you can find the antidote, the opposite, and come up with your mantra that can really reassure you.
Yeah. That makes sense. It absolutely does. And what about the ways we engage with others? Any tips for developing confidence interpersonally?
Yeah, there are lots. And this is something I loved writing about in the book because it's so concrete. It's something each of us can do differently next time we're with a group or mm-hmm. our partner or a colleague or a friend. Here's one, especially for people who maybe are trying to regain their confidence after a lot of social isolation, you know, and feeling rusty. And I call it the dog principle. I have a 1-year-old puppy, a Newfoundland puppy. And one of the things I notice about dogs is when a new person comes into the room, what do they do? What do they do?
They get excited. Sometimes they start jumping up and down, and they may want to run to the person. It probably depends on the dog.
Yeah, but you got it. They approach the person. And what do they not do? They don't sit there and overthink it. They don't go talk to their friends about that this person just came in. They approach the person. And in the same way, I encourage people interpersonally, socially, if you want more confidence, be the first. Be the first one to go up to the new person and say, "Hi, welcome. My name is." Be the first to go up to the new manager that just joined your team and say, like, "Hi, I'm so and so. If you don't have lunch plans today, it'd be great to get together." It doesn't always have to be an invitation, it can just be a greeting. But
Absolutely.
be the first. It can change dramatically how you see yourself. From, "Oh, I'm socially awkward and not fit for a networking event like this," to, "Wait, I can initiate conversations." And by applying that rule, the dog principle, it's amazing how you can quickly get out of overthinking, over analysis, and be a lot braver than you think.
Wow. And that's why networking is so important, and building, and also because you want to build that support network so that you have that support that you need to help you in those times when you feel like, okay, I my confidence here, I need someone I can go to Selena and I know she's gonna give me some words of wisdom, something that will help me to get through this or what have you. So that's why it's always good with the networking and the building a support network so that you can have something in place also too that so you don't always have to do these things by yourself. So that's one of the ways I look at it, to build that support network, have positive people around you. And that also helps, I think, to increase your confidence and level on some respects.
I think that's so true, the networking aspect, and like no, person who's building confidence can be an island. You really need those other people. And one of the powerful things I think we can do, particularly as women, is share some of our tough moments, like our face plants, our missteps, our fails, not just the wonderful, like glittering triumphs, which are also meaningful and we can learn a lot from. But I think that's so important, particularly for those early stage professionals who may be feeling a real hit to their confidence that they see,
They're
listen,
not the only ones there,
we're not the only ones. And
and get through, and they got through it, you know?
yes, and that a well-lived life often requires challenging your own comfort, pushing the bounds of your confidence. That a well-lived life isn't arriving one day at just utter perfect confidence. It's the idea that you are going to be pushed. You are going to stand at the edge of what's comfortable, and you're going to be
Absolutely.
okay.
Absolutely. Wow. So what confidence shifts has made the biggest difference for you personally?
I think it really comes down to stop overestimating what everybody else can do and underestimating what you can do. I see lots, I hear lots of people, clients talk about that. "Oh, I'd like to do that one day." And then they look at some of their idols doing it and say, "But I'm not ready. They are so good at it. I could never go to their level. I'm just too uncomfortable to start." We've all been there. We've all felt those ways, like, oh, I'm just not a good candidate for that. And we talk ourselves out of it before someone else has a chance to, like, even assess our readiness or our competence and or our passion. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's been just a huge learning in my life. Frankly, Dr. Lewis, something I am continuing to learn and repeat to myself when I disqualify myself from something or say, oh, I don't know. I don't know if I can. Mm-hmm. Pushing back and saying, you know what? Let me not overestimate what everyone else is doing and underestimate what I can do. Because you know what? They all had a day one at something. They all were a newbie at something. They
True. It's like if she can do it, I can do it too. It's, you know, I always say, I'm not, you know, I am not any better than what you are. If I was able to do it, then you can do it too. But you have to put yourself out there. And you have to have confidence in yourself, faith that you can, you know, and do it. But it's not going to fall from the sky. It's not going to drop in your lap. You have to step out there and do it.
It's true. And I think we all know by extension, when you show up like you belong, when you raise your hand because you know you have that value to offer, guess what? You're training other people how to think about you now. Exactly. And you're training them to think, oh, she has got something to say. Mm-hmm. Or yes, let's pick her next time we need someone to stand up and give a presentation, whatever it may be. But, you know, it's not just the self message. We're also sending a powerful message to everyone else out there about how to think of us.
Right. It's like, I remember somebody said, and I don't remember who it was, could have just been a friend or it may have been a quote from something, but I heard them say that great people don't walk around saying they're great. Great people are people that's doing great things. And so if you look at it that way and you know that, you know, you're here because you have something to offer and you have to put yourself out there and put what you have, your gift, your talent out there and let other people know about it. Because if you just, you know, sit back and be invisible, then who's ever don't speak up. You don't, like I said, if you don't speak up, who's going to notice? Who's going to ever notice you? So you have to put yourself out there. And that does require a certain level of confidence and definitely confidence in yourself, your abilities and in your worth and your value.
Well, and it's true, right? Because you think about people, maybe you've helped in the past, maybe someone who came to you. It's a lot easier to help somebody who's willing to tell you, hey, I'm looking for a role in marketing. Do you know somebody or could you connect me with somebody in that kind of job function? Or I'm looking to be in the Baltimore area. Can you help me meet people who live or work in that area? Right. It's so much easier to respond. And when you look around, many people in your network want to help, are very happy to help, but it's on us to articulate clearly what we're looking for. And you know, I think that's on each of us to really make that clear. Cause I don't think we can be too clear when we're asking a favor or looking to level up in our careers and we need our network's help. I don't think we can be too clear, too, you know, precise in asking for what we need.
Absolutely. So what's a parting truth bomb you want to leave the guests with when it comes to confidence?
Yes. You know, one of the things I've noticed through my research, through writing Quick Confidence, is the most confident people keep the promises they make to themselves. And so I want to encourage anybody who's listening to think about that and reflect on in your own life, the concept of making a promise and then keeping it is very important to us humans. And brain researchers have found that it has pretty big consequences when we keep a promise. You know, think about it. If someone gives you $5 and you give it back, here you go. Here's your $5 back. Mm-hmm. It feels good to make good on that promise. We all get a little like ego cookie that mm-hmm. feels good. I made good on that promise. Here's your blouse back that I borrowed, you know? And look, the opposite is true too.
Mm-hmm.
When we make promises to ourselves, whatever that could be, right, in your life, I'm going to make time for the gym this morning. Mm-hmm. I'm going to hit send on that job application. I mm-hmm. promised myself I would do X. We get a reward, you know, all kinds of feel good rewards when we do that. Right. And when we don't, it feels bad. It feels like we're the flaky coworker who you can't trust, you know, because they don't do what they say they'll do.
Exactly. So,
one of the parting truth bombs I have for this set of wonderful listeners is keep those promises to yourself. And if you need to shrink the number of promises you make to yourself, mm-hmm. you know, don't overpromise. Mm-hmm. Really think twice before you say yes to that task or that to-do or that aspiration and say, can I realistically, you know, make good on this.
Absolutely.
And that's been a tremendous confidence builder in my own life and for my clients too.
Wow. So tell us, if we wanted to get a copy of your book, or your books, I should say, where could we do that? And also let us know if someone wanted to reach out to you, how can they do so?
Yes. Thank you for asking. For anybody who'd like to pre-order Quick Confidence, it is out on May 9th, but it's available right now for pre-order at Amazon, barnesandnoble.com, and Books A Million. So really anywhere books are sold online, you should be able to find it. And you'll be the first to get it if you pre-order. And you can find me, and I'd love to hear from all of you. Please do share your wins, your challenges when it comes to confidence. I want to hear them all. You can visit my website, which is selinaresvani.com. And you can also email me, selina@selinaresvani.com.
Wow. Any upcoming events or anything that you have that you might want to share with us?
Well, you know what? A lot of the ones coming up happen to be private for certain corporations, okay. But if anybody's looking for it, you can find me dropping new content, leadership and confidence building content every day on TikTok and Instagram, LinkedIn as well. And my handle is my name, Selina Resvani. So say hi there if you're on any of those social platforms.
Great. Well, thank you. It's been a joy to have you on the show. So glad that, again, that we were able to connect and get you on to share some of your great your success nuggets on confidence. Definitely, because that's always one of the things that I talk about a lot is because the women and confidence and making sure that they go for those things and not just say, I can't without even trying. So really appreciate you coming on and sharing information on that.
Well, thank you too. I really appreciate your work and your message. So thank you for what you do to lift women up.
Thank you. Just want to give some upcoming events to those, to the viewers and listeners out there. Make sure that you mark your calendar for the Come and Relax, Rewind, and Release at the Show Up to Rise Up Women's Retreat, which is taking place April 21st. Through the 23rd at Lake Anna, Virginia. You can email me for registration information. You email me at info@exwsi.com. Also, stay tuned for the Own It Anthology book launch that will be taking place February 19th, 2023 at 7 p.m. You will have the opportunity to meet the authors, including me. I'm also in this anthology, and you'll be able to hear some of our stories, The pre-sale of the book will be in March. Also join me February 27th through March 3rd at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for the 1 Million Women Rise Up webinar. During this webinar, we're going to be discussing some key points in your professional development. So make sure you mark your calendar for February 27th through March 3rd at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I also like to remind you that if you have not viewed my TEDx talk, make sure that you do so. The topic, of course, is Show Up to Rise Up. You can watch it on YouTube. Just put in my name in the search box, Dr. Madeline Ann Lewis, or you can send me an email to info@exwsi.com, and I will send you the direct link. Still pushing the video out there. We're still at we're over 152,000 and some views. So very happy about that. I'm also a contributing writer to the Own It magazine, where I share nuggets and resources every month. Own It magazine is a resource for personal and professional development and business development. So if you want a subscription for an annual subscription, you can go to my website, www.exwsi.com, to get a subscription. And also, I think that's all of the announcements. So thank you I want to thank my guest again for joining me, Ms. Selena Rezvani. I also want to thank my viewers and my listeners for joining us today. This is the Successful Women Show. I'm Dr. Madeline Ann Lewis. And if you'd like to reach out to me, you can email me at info@exwsi.com or go to my website, www.exwsi.com. And while you're there, make sure you download my free 3-part video series on 3 things every woman should do to position herself for executive leadership. Also, my online course, you can sign up for that, which is Crack the Career Code, How to Lead with Confidence, Charisma, and Credibility. To sign up for the course, go to www.crackthecareercode.com. Again, you can reach me on all the social media platforms. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel, the Talk for TV channel, and my YouTube channel. Make sure that you go on and like the episode, share this episode with others so they can get the benefit of the great nuggets that we received today. Again, this is the Successful Women Show. We're here every Thursday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I am your host, Dr. Madeline Ann Lewis, helping women to accelerate the path to success. Thank you again for joining me. I love you all to life. And as always, be well and stay safe out there. I got